Hey guys, thank you for joining me. Today we are going to be talking about different sparkling wines around the world. So we're going to be talking a little bit about champagne, Prosecco, Cava, but also some other sparkling wines you might not have heard of. So what really makes a sparkling wine? Well, a sparkling wine is just a wine that goes through the normal winemaking process, but then takes a second fermentation. This second fermentation can be made either in the bottle or in a tank method, as we talked about in our last video. And something that makes all of these different sparkling wines around the world different are sort of three ideas. One is the way they're made, so if it's tank or traditional method. The other is where they're made, the climate, the soil, and of course the third is the grapes they're made with. So let's go ahead and jump into the most popular sparkling wine, of course, champagne. Champagne is called so because it actually comes from the Champagne region of France. Many people say that Dom Perignon was the inventor of champagne. However, this isn't exactly true. Even though he did play a part, champagne was sort of made originally on accident, in fact, where there was a little bit leftover yeast and sugar in the bottle, and the bottles would actually explode. So people thought it was the devil's wine because all of a sudden all these bottles were exploding. But over time, they realized that it was something happening to the wine to make this sort of fizzy wine. And so actually in about the 1500s, Benedictine monks did start to make champagne as a wine itself, as a sparkling wine itself. So champagne is actually made in the traditional method. That means the second fermentation happens in the bottled. Basically, the grapes are harvested, they're manually pressed, they go through the normal fermentation process, but after being clarified, the winemaker will make the blend how they want, deciding the final taste. Then they'll add the wine to the bottle, add a little bit of extra yeast, add a little bit of extra sugar, close that bottle and let the second fermentation happen and make the champagne sparkling. When you do this in the traditional method, you actually have to store the bottles at a 45 degree angle and every day go in and give them a quarter turn. Champagne does this for about 15 months if it's going to be a normal brew champagne. Instead of it's going to be labeled as a millésime or a vintage, it's going to stay in that process for 36 months. So the great thing about champagne is that it's really versatile. You can change up the grapes you're making with it, and it can really be paired with so many different foods. So it's really a great sparkling wine. The grapes usually used when making champagne are Pinot Noir, Chardonnay, and Meunier. And these three grapes sort of each have their own little characteristic. For example, Pinot Noir is actually a red grape, but depending on how much you press it, it can make white wine or red wine. If you're making a rosé version, this is a popular grape to just leave it with its skin a little and get a light pink color. The Pinot Noir grape actually adds a lot of beautiful perfumes of red fruits into the mix. Then of course there's Chardonnay, one of the most popular grapes to use when making champagne. The thing about Chardonnay that's really great is it helps the wine stay longer. So it's really used when you want that wine to keep a little bit longer and be a little bit more aged. Then of course there is Meunier, which has a little bit more of a fruity character, and it also develops pretty quickly, so it's a popular blending grape. Other grapes that you might find in champagne blends might be Pinot Gris or Pinot Grigio, Pinot Blanc, and also Arban. There's a few others that grow in the area, these just tend to be the most common. Champagne has very fine bubbles and a fruity character. You can purchase it at different sweetness levels, but it does sort of lean to a drier wine. But then, of course, there's the more affordable alternative, Prosecco. So what makes Prosecco so different from champagne? Well, one, Prosecco is made in Italy. It has a little bit of a different area. And then, of course, Prosecco is made with the tank method rather than the traditional method. This means the second fermentation happens in a pressurized tank and usually only takes a few days rather than a few months. This means that it can go through a little faster and the whole process is a bit less expensive to do, therefore the end wine is a little bit more affordable. Prosecco is actually made with this one grape called Galera, and it is a grape that comes from the northeast of Italy. You'll find this wine is usually made in Veneto or Friuli Venezia Giulia. And the thing about it is Prosecco gets its name from a town called Prosecco, which is actually in the Friuli Venezia Giulia region. However, nowadays, if you're really looking for a top quality of Prosecco, you're going to find it more towards Veneto. So there are actually 9 areas that can make Prosecco under the DOC regulations, meaning the quality controlled regions, okay? But then the highest quality, you should look for the DOCG, which means the quality is controlled, checked, and guaranteed. And the DOCG, if you ever look at Italian wines, DOCG is sort of the way to go. So the Prosecco regions that are DOCG are Conegliano and Valdobbiadene, okay? These are sort of the best areas to look out when you're buying a Prosecco. If you really, really want a great Prosecco, you should look out for Superiore di Cartizze. Superiore di Cartizze is known to have some of the best area to grow Glera and also produce some of the best Prosecco. In fact, this area, this region, has the highest value of vineyard land in Italy. It's very expensive to grow grapes there, and because it's such a great place for these Glera grapes. So we've covered Champagne, we've covered Prosecco. The third most popular in Europe happens to be Cava, which is a sparkling wine from Spain. Cava is made very close to Barcelona, okay, so in Catalonia, and its name comes from cave because this wine used to be stored in caves. It's actually a fairly recent sparkling wine in terms of the history of it. It really became produced around the 1800s, and then the name Cava actually didn't come around and stick to this wine until about the 1970s because they needed a name that wasn't going to confuse with Champagne for legal reasons. So Cava, what is Cava? Cava is again produced in the traditional method, so the second fermentation happens in the bottle. Cava is primarily made with a native Spanish grape called Macabeo, but it could also be made with a few other native grapes, as well as a few international grapes. It's sort of up to the producer at this point. The wines are often a little bit less sweet than Prosecco, and they tend to have some nice lemony or pear undertones to them. Now, as I mentioned, you can find sparkling wine all around the world from any region. In fact, you can even find some California sparkling wines. A lot of California sparkling wines tend to be made with Chardonnay. Many producers are using the traditional method, but you can use the tank method. If you find a traditional method sparkling Chardonnay from California, it's really interesting to kind of compare it to a Champagne, because you can see the differences between the cool climate of a Champagne region and the warm climate of California and sort of see how it changes the wine. But let's talk about some of the other famous sparkling wines that you maybe not have heard of as often that come from over here in Europe. So, one is Cremant, which again is another French sparkling wine, but it is made outside of the Champagne region. These wines are really interesting because they have a very creamy and nutty character to them, so it's just a little bit something different. Then another wine that's really interesting to look out for is coming from Germany, and it's called Sekt. This sparkling wine from Germany is a very low sugar, very low alcohol, usually only around 6%, and so it's just sort of something more easy drinkable, I guess. It also has a lot of perfumes of pears and white flowers. It can be made in either the tank method or the traditional method. So after you know the different international styles of wine, something you're going to want to keep in mind is also the different levels of sweetness in the wine. Because sparkling wine can come in a different range of sweetness, and knowing which style you like is going to help you in the future pick out which bottle you want to buy. So we have certain terms to define how sweet a wine is going to be. Starting from the driest, we have extra brut, extra dry, and then the sweetest is called demi-sec. Now, if we're going to look at different styles of wine, the extra brut is usually the style that Cava is made in, and this means that there's barely any residual sugar left at all. This style of wine tends to pair very nicely with salty or savory foods. A lot of people say like sashimi or possibly oysters or even french fries. This is sort of a good sparkling wine for that. Moving up a level, we get to brut, which is the style most common for Champagne. And this style goes really well with some cheese plates and also some sort of earthy flavors, like maybe mushrooms. If we go another step higher with even a little bit more sugar, residual sugar in the wine, we reach the extra dry. Extra dry tends to be what Prosecco is. So it's not saying that the wine is really sweet. You're not necessarily going to feel the sweetness or the sugar. But you can think of it as a little bit less dry than the others is the best way to describe it. That being said, Prosecco does usually have more residual sugar than the other wines. And this wine, again, it goes really well, of course, by itself. It also goes really well with cheeses, salumi, and more vegetable dishes. Finally, we get to the sweetest level, which is demi-sec. Now, demi-sec ends up being sort of more a dessert wine. It's got a lot of residual sugar left over. And this is the sweet sparkling wine that you are going to want with strawberries, with chocolates. Cheesecake is a really good one. This you might find sort of around the New Year's. A lot of times there might be these sweeter sparkling wines. And so it's something interesting to keep in mind. If you do prefer sweet wines, look out for the label demi-sec. Otherwise, play around with the different labels and find out what sparkling wine is the best for you. So I hope you enjoyed this video. I hope you learned a little bit more about how to identify different sparkling wines. I would love to hear what your favorite sparkling wines are and just what you think about the different international styles. So go ahead and leave us a comment. Please remember to like, subscribe, and follow along for some more awesome wine content.